Hello everyone, welcome to the Current Gyan. Today we are going to read an article written by Sekhar Gupta. So let us begin these articles. Five reason of crisis in the global Islam. In the tens of the crores of Muslims across the world feel they are the victims of mass Islamophobia. Their whole prophet shown deliberate disrespect. It is a sense of crisis and seize. So you can see here what he has written in this article, that we know that the French president Emmanuel Macron merely dared to say the Islam is in crisis and got himself into a big trouble. Turkey, Recep Tayyip Erdogan asks him to get his head examined. Pakistan, Imran Khan wrote two-page sermon to a fellow Muslim nation calling for a re-education of West about Islam. No such restraints of the Malaysia of 95 years old Mahathir Muhammad. He got so furious as he nearly justified mass killing of a French for what they have done to the Muslim in the past. Besides, indeed of condemning the decadent Christians only in the name West, where women often walk around with no more than a little string that covers the most secret place. Protests broke out in Pakistan, Bangladesh and India. But did the Macron speak the truth or not? The reaction of these prominent leaders from the powerful and populous Muslim countries points to the crisis. If tens of the crores of Muslims across the world feels they are the victims of mass Islamophobia, it is a sense of a seize and crisis. Unlike a scared scripture, however, there can be many versions of what this truth is. Here is this humble editorial list effort. Let us break it down in five broad points. First point here, writer talks about all the religions are politicals. At this point, though, Islam is most politicized. You can surely hark back to the centuries of Christian crusaders, but that was sometimes back. Doesn't matter if that imaginary is often evoked by the leaders of Al-Qaeda, ISIS, and sometimes also the odd, angry Islamic nation. So Islam is also the second largest faith in the world, with nearly 200 crore adherents just behind the Christians, about 20%. Like Christian, Muslims also live across the world, but unlike the Christian, in the countries where there have a majority, few people have democracy. That's a checkable fact. Important to note, about 60% of all the Muslims are in Asia, and four of their largest population in the world live under the different degrees of democracy between India, Indonesia, Bangladesh and Pakistan. Stretching this argument further, in the countries where the Muslims have majority, secularism is general a bad word or the Western concept. But in the democratic nation where the Muslims are in minority, they persistently put the Republic secular commitment to test. France, Britain, US, Belgium, Germany are the good example. There is a reason I do not include India here, because unlike the Europe to which they migrate lately, in Indian Muslims were equally and voluntarily partner in forming the new republic. Second point he talks about is that there is an unresolved tension among the Muslim population and nations between the nationalism and pan-nationalisms. This arises from the concept of Ummaha, that's all the Muslim of the world are in the one supranational it identity. Check this out from the Imran Khan two-page discourse of his fellow Ummah leaders, who have seen this expressed in his subcontinent sometimes. In the Caliphate movement in 1919 to 1924, protesting against the Kemal Ataturk winding up of the Ottoman Caliphate and founding the Turkish Republic, to a Salman Rushdie, to a now fading support of Palestine and now France. So there are some interesting consequences here. While the notion is a pan-Islamism, many more wars are fought between the Muslim and Muslim states than with others. The Iran wars was the longest. Large number of Islamic states joined the coalition against the Saddam under the US, closer home in the Afghan-Pakistan region. Muslims only kill Muslims, not all of them, in a Friday bombing at Shia mosques. Last time we were truly pan-Islamic alliance fight against a common non-Muslim enemy was Six-Day War in 1967 against Israel. There was a beat it again in the Yom Kippur War in 1973, but the Egypt and Jordan signed up for the peace. Iran is left mostly alone to fight Israel from a distance. Syria has self-destructed. In none of the Pakistan's war against the India has the Islamic nation come to its aid, barring Jordan transferring some F-104 starfighters in 1971. Third point he talks about is, which brings us to a brutality irony, if a pan-Islamism, the Ummah spirit, has worked on the ground, it is with the multinational terror groups. All Al-Qaeda and ISIS are truly pan-Islamic nations, organizations, which mostly target the settled Islamic state. ISIS actually says that if you believe in that all the Muslims are the part of same Ummah, then they must have a caliphate subsuming international boundaries and enforcing the common Sharia. Afghanistan, Syria, Iraq, Libya, keeping counting, this should also make us reflect on why it is so few Muslims from the subcontinent, home to one third of all the Muslims, are seen in Al-Qaeda or ISIS. The argument I put forward is that in this debate is, in our nations, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, nationalism trumps pan-Islamism. So Muslims in these countries have flag and cricket teams to support, a leader to love or hate, and if they hate him, to vote him out of the protest in any preferred manner, they prefer some mythical caliphate. Fourth is the crippling contradictions. There are the sharp nation's boundaries dividing the Muslim population and wealth. The bulk of the populations in the Asia Africa lives in a poor economies, whereas the world wealthiest nation, the Gulf Arabs, are respectively minuscule populations. They want to distribute their wealth equally to the rest of the spirit of pan-Islamism. They are happy to find a compact with the West and now also with the India and Israel, but of them, everything, their political power, royal privilege, global structures depends on that one thing, pan-Islamism challenge, status quo. Nobody has an answer to this GDP population mismatch, and the rise of the power like ISIS only further fortifies these walls. Number fifth and the last, because of the democratic deficit in the most of the Islamic countries, we cannot even protest, express your resettlement against terrorism. You must feel sickened that your royalty is sold of American Satan, but you cannot do nothing about it, not shout a slogan, wave a placard, write a blog, write an editorial, even tweet. This could land into a jail and forever and get beheaded. So you go and do it where you can. So that is why in 2003 I wrote a national interest headline, Globalizations of Revenge. So because you cannot do any of this in your country, do it in Europe, America. You cannot even whisper a word in anger in your brutally control national security state, so you can go another where you can freely leave train to be air pilot and then slam those planes into the twin tower, where even the Khalid Sheikh Mohammed has a right to somehow fair trial. You cannot fight your masters, so why not punish the master's masters? Isn't that this globalization of revenge? In conclusion, let's return to the killing of Samuel Paty in France. The killer has Abdullah Anzorov, an 18-year-old from a Chechen Republic family. Chechnya is a tiny Russian republic of North Caucasus with just over a million population. 95% of them are Muslims. Russian subdued their separatist rebellion after two brutal war, but by the time normalcy came, half of that little population was living in refugee camps. Many sought a better life in the Western democracy, like this teenage assassin family. Let's reconstruct the jigsaw. When Chechnya fought a jihad against Russia, many Muslim fighters from across the world, including many veterans of Afghanistan, joined them. Because of this all, they had learned to fight a jihad against the Russians. Pan-Islamism led to death, destruction and mass deinstitutions of Chechens. Tens of thousands have escaped to liberal democracy of safety, a better life and peace. Now, they also want a compliance with their own social and religious values theirs. To decide what you are, cartoonists can draw and teachers can teach. Reflect this and then debate if the 5 points are detailed and earlier make sense. So with this, we'll end this lecture. Thank you.